Bonjour et bienvenue à cette célébration venue de l'église de Saint-Andrew et Saint-Paul sur le premier dimanche d'Avent. Hello and welcome to our weekly service from the Church of Saint-Andrew and Saint-Paul. Today on the first Sunday of Advent, the time when we begin our countdown to the day when we can proclaim once again that a Savior has been born for us in the city of Bethlehem. It's a time of year when I know many of you find the tradition so wonderful and full, and I'm sure you've been looking forward to them. Unfortunately, this year it's going to be different, and we won't be able to congregate together as we love to do when the church is full and the music rings out in every corner of that beautiful building. But nonetheless, even online, we know that we will be providing you with many opportunities to enjoy the special nature of this season as we greet it with hope, peace, love, and joy. Today, on the first Sunday of Advent, as usual, we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper. And so I invite you to find some bread and some wine or grape juice so that we can join together in that sacrament. As we begin every service, we will begin with the lighting of the Advent candle.
The season of Advent begins, and we celebrate the hope we find in the good news of the gospel.
Through the birth of a tiny and helpless child, God comes to save the world.
While we watch and wait for Jesus, we join God's mission by bringing grace and mercy to those who need it most.
We engage the poor and the poor in spirit, letting Christ's light shine through us.
We speak words of comfort and love to a world in need of hope and healing as we share our stories of God's transforming spirit.
Together we are a sign of God's hope for the world.
Let us pray.
God of surprising grace, when we least expect it, you bring fresh new life. And where we feel that all is lost, you bring redemption. Give us courage as we share all you have done, all you are doing, and all you will accomplish through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in the season of Advent that we are beginning, we will be reminded that this is a time to wait as we anticipate your coming into our world in so many ways, and especially in the tiny baby born in Bethlehem. We are entering a time of promise waiting to be fulfilled, of looking forward with hope, of expectation of what is to come, what surprises and mysteries, what revelations and discoveries lie ahead of us. Today we praise you as the God of the future, in whom time, from beginning to end, from birth to death, from Alpha to Omega, is firmly in your hands. We enter this time of waiting, but you know that waiting is not easy for us. We are restless souls who always want to be in charge. And when we are waiting, we become anxious as we realize that we have lost control, unable to determine what will happen or when. In these pandemic days, we have grown anxious with waiting, unable to see a future beyond what we are now living, cut off from having any notion of when we can return to the many things that we miss. Forgive us, Holy One, for not trusting the future to you, for our unwillingness to leave it with you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, Advent has much to teach us for these days. Perhaps God gives us this season in order that we can learn that this time of waiting is not wasted time, not hopeless time, not treading water time, but a time of waiting that can be used well, as a time of renewal, as a time of hope, as a time of anticipation, as a time of watching. Waiting is fruitful time when we dare to trust that whatever the future will hold, God will be there to greet us. And so I invite you to live in the present time as renewed, forgiven, and beloved people of God.
Just like to take a few moments to highlight a number of the announcements that you can find in your bulletin today. First, with regards to the fall fair, the online sale ends this Tuesday, so you still have some time to make some purchases. Very importantly, I'd like to say a sincere and a warm word of thanks to the many, many people behind the scenes who made this year's fall fair a tremendous success. On Tuesday, a very important event is happening. It's the benefit concert for Maison du Parc. If you'd like to attend this free concert, please check out the bulletin and it will show you how to obtain a ticket. Secondly, and importantly, if you'd like to donate to this very important cause, please check out our bulletin and it will also guide you as to how to do that. On Thursday at 5:30 p.m., our Advent Chapel services continue. This week we welcome as our guest preacher, the Reverend Dr. Jason Biasey, and we also welcome as our guest musician, Emmanuel Vukovic. Lastly, I'd like to draw your attention to a book study that's being held on Wednesdays at 11 a.m. entitled Light of the World. If you're interested in being part of this book study, please contact the office to register and to obtain a copy of the book. These are all the announcements. Let us continue to worship God.
The first lesson is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 64, verse 1 to verse 9. Listen for God's word. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil. To make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Amen. Here ends the first lesson.
La deuxième lecture nous vient de l'Évangile selon Saint Marc, chapitre 13, les versets 24 à 37. Écoutons la parole de Dieu. Mais ces jours-là, après ce temps de détresse, le soleil s'obscurcira, la lune ne donnera plus sa lumière, les étoiles tomberont du ciel et les puissances célestes seront ébranlées. Alors, on verra le Fils de l'homme venir sur les nuées avec beaucoup de puissance et de gloire. Il enverra ses anges et rassemblera ceux qu'il a choisis des quatre coins du monde, de l'extrémité de la terre jusqu'à l'extrémité du ciel. Tirez instruction de la parabole du figuier. Dès que ses branches deviennent tendres et que les feuilles poussent, vous savez que l'été est proche. De même, quand vous verrez ces choses arriver, sachez que le Fils de l'homme est proche, qu'il est à la porte. Je vous le dis en vérité, cette génération ne passera pas avant que tout cela n'arrive. Le ciel et la terre disparaîtront, mais mes paroles ne disparaîtront pas. Quant au jour et à l'heure, personne ne les connaît, pas même les anges dans le ciel, ni le Fils. Le Père seul les connaît. Faites bien attention, restez en éveil et priez, car vous ignorez quand ce temps viendra. Cela se passera comme pour un homme qui part en voyage. Il laisse sa maison, remet l'autorité à ses serviteurs, indique à chacun son travail et ordonne au portier de rester éveillé. Restez donc vigilants, car vous ne savez pas quand viendra le maître de la maison, le soir ou au milieu de la nuit, ou au chant du coq ou le matin, qu'il ne vous trouve pas endormi quand il arrivera tout à coup. Ce que je vous dis, je le dis à tous. Restez vigilants. La parole de Dieu, rendons grâce à Dieu.
Thank you.
Amid any personal, communal, or national crisis, faith in God can be severely tested. One could argue that the anguished plea that we find at the beginning of our Old Testament reading today from Isaiah is representative of a nation on the edge of desperation, exhausted from waiting and questioning the God who had freed the people from slavery so long, long ago. What has happened to the people of Israel since we met them at the edge of the Promised Land way back in the book of Deuteronomy? And why does their prophet Isaiah now call upon God to come down from the heavens like a warrior, shaking mountains and creating environmental chaos in the process? Well, it's been many years since the people crossed that river and set foot in the Promised Land. Sadly, during the intervening period, they have suffered many calamities. Scholars tell us that the final 11 chapters of the book of Isaiah reflect the situation that they find themselves in. They have been beaten in war. Their kingdom has been conquered, their temple decimated, and the bulk of their upper and lower classes have been deported, leaving the poorest of the poor left to fend for themselves in a ravaged landscape that was once deemed a promised land. But after a long period of exile, hundreds of miles away, with years of longing and waiting, the deportees' dream of returning has finally become a reality. Their oppressors have been defeated at last. But the joy of returning to the Promised Land is short-lived. There is unexpected friction between the people who had been exiled and the people who had stayed all along. And what is more, the temple they have managed to rebuild, an institution central to their national identity, is nowhere near the splendor of the temple that was built by King Solomon centuries before. So, in desperation, the prophet Isaiah calls out to God to come down as a military-style hero to solve the people's problems, to destroy their enemies, settle their disputes, and restore the kingdom to its former glory. And while we might be shocked by this call to God to intervene in this way, let us recall that God had performed awesome deeds on behalf of the people like this in the past. The plagues on Egypt that forced Pharaoh to let Israel go is one example. Another example is the deliverance of Israel at the Red Sea. And another one, if you recall, is the manna that fell from heaven to feed the people of Israel whilst in the wilderness. These are just some of the ways that God had intervened for God's people at times of crisis in their history. But where is their God now? The fact is, God has not been around in a long time, and the people are exhausted, exasperated, and deeply frustrated at waiting. Does God no longer care for them, or is their protection only a collective memory of their past? Has God finally done what many of the people thought God would do? Has God abandoned them, resulting in their current misery? The prophet places the burden of Israel's current situation squarely on the shoulders of Israel itself. In startling and uncomfortable words, we are told in verse 6 of our text that all of Israel has become as one who is unclean, where all their righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. The prophet names the cold, hard reality of the people's relationship with God in verse 7. I quote, "There is no one who calls on your name, nor attempts to take hold of you. These people are in dire straits. The ancient covenantal relationship, which goes as far back as Abraham in the book of Genesis, is in grave danger of being completely severed. The situation is only made worse by the suggestion that God has hidden God's face from them. But just at a point when all seems lost, and when the distance between God and the people seems too great, Isaiah, on behalf of the people, makes a startling profession. "Yet, O Lord," he says, "you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people." In just 9 verses, we see a tremendous movement of grace, where the image of God as a cosmic military-like figure who intervenes in a military-like way is re-envisioned to that of a potter working and molding and fashioning a broken people in a constant, caring and loving way. At the beginning of Advent, this passage reminds all of us, particularly this year in the midst of a pandemic, that none of us are in control of very much in life, and that we all need God's help to see us through. And this God is not distant from us. This God has not abandoned us. Rather, this is a gracious God who really does want to help, to shape, and to guide us in our lives. This reality is never made more clearer than when God lovingly and graciously molds the divine self on Christmas Day as an impoverished, displaced infant. May this understanding of God comfort us when we wait through the strangeness, the loneliness, and the isolation of this particular Advent season. May it reassure us as we adjust to a reality very different to that, well, that of any experience any of us have lived before. And may our belief in the graciousness of God free us from worry and anxiety about how this season will turn out, and instead help us to focus on our journey through Advent. A journey to the wonderment, the gratitude, and the elation of Christmas morning. A Christmas morning where, by sending God's self to us, God really does consider us to be God's people, a people deeply loved by a gracious God. May it be so this first Sunday of Advent, because it is to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit that we can give praise and glory both now and forevermore. Amen.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. We're told that the people will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, to sit at the great banquet table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when the risen Christ was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them, and then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. This is the Lord's table. He invites those who trust him to share the feast that he has prepared. I invite you to join me in the Apostles' Creed, a statement of faith first used in the 4th century and still used by many churches as a foundational document of faith. Please join me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. Let us listen to the words of the institution of the Lord's Supper as recorded by the Apostle Paul. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the risen Lord until he comes. Just as Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, we take these common elements of bread and wine to be used for this great mystery. And as he gave thanks, let us draw near to God and offer our prayers and thanksgiving.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God. We give you thanks that in the creation of our world, when you laid the earth's foundation and set its cornerstone in place, the morning stars sang in chorus, and the angels of God all shouted for joy. By the power of your Spirit, you made the universe. By the might of your word, you gave us life. And we give thanks that in the new creation, when you gave your Son to raise us up again, since we and all our human race had fallen, you claimed us for your own people, that we might proclaim the glorious deeds of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. By the life of your Spirit, you fill the hearts of the faithful. By the light of your word, you give us strength and love. And now we give thanks that in the coming of Christ, the day of our deliverance is dawning. For he comes to judge the world with justice and the people by his faithfulness. We wait for the Lord with longing, like those who watch for morning. For the Lord is love unfailing, and great is his power to save. Therefore, with your people of all places and times, we proclaim your greatness with the whole company of heaven, who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Thank you.
in tune with all the heavenly hosts. We here on earth acknowledge your glory and give you thanks that in the fullness of time you sent your Son to be our Saviour. We bless you for his incarnation among us, his holy birth, his perfect life on earth, his suffering for us, and his triumph over death, for his ascension to your right hand, and his gift of the Holy Spirit, and for the promise of his coming again. Remembering his work and passion, and pleading his eternal sacrifice, we follow his example and obey his command. Send down your Holy Spirit to bless us and these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread which we break may be for us the communion of the body of Christ, and the cup of blessing which we bless, the communion of the blood of Christ, that we, receiving them by faith, may be made partakers of his body and blood, with all his benefits to nourish us and to help us grow in grace, to the glory of your most holy name. And here we offer and present to you our very selves to be a living sacrifice, dedicated and fit for your acceptance, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we say together the prayer that Jesus teaches all his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink of it, do this in memory of me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I invite you to eat and drink. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the love which brings us as food from heaven, the life of your dear Son, and assures us that we belong to the company of all of his faithful people in heaven and on earth. Grant that strengthened by this fellowship and by the power of his Spirit, we may continue his work in the world until we come to the glory of your eternal kingdom through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, both now, today, and indeed for evermore.